Hi, I'm Donovan Brown, Principal DevOps Manager from Microsoft. Load testing is a great way to find issues in your software before your users do. Make sure as your application grows in popularity, it is ready for the additional load. There are several ways using Azure, Visual Studio Team Services, and Visual Studio to get started with load testing. Let's jump right in and let me show you how you get started. If your application is already being hosted in Azure, the quickest way to get started is just to go to that app service. On the app service blade itself is a way for you to start a performance test. Just scroll all the way down to the developer tools, and here you're going to see performance test. When you click on performance test, it's going to give you the ability to create a very quick and easy performance test right here in the Azure portal. To get started, you just click on new, and from here you get to choose the URL for which you want to test. This happens to be a URL for a web service, but if I already hit this URL directly, what you're going to actually see is a web page. That's not what I want. What I want to do is drill into the api.people, and when I click on this, you're going to see that it's a web service bringing back some XML results. That's what I actually want to load test. So I'm simply going to copy that and then paste that as the URL that I want to go and do a get against. When that is done, I'm then able to give the test a name, decide where in the world that I want to actually run the test, and then also what the load that I want to run on this particular test and for how long. I've already done this. And what you'll see is you'll get the test results just like this one. These are the results of a load test running with 250 concurrent users against that same endpoint. You can see the response time, you can see how many failed requests that we had, and get a quick overview on what's the health of my application and will I be able to sustain the load that we're looking for. Also down here at the bottom, you'll be able to see the CPU time and memory usage to see if the scale unit that you have is big enough or not. And if not, you can decide to scale it up right now and make sure that you're going to be ready for the load. This information is not only surfaced here in the Azure portal, it's also surfaced inside of Visual Studio Team Services. If I were to click on this link here, I'll be taken to the account that's backing this particular application. And from here, I can simply click on my load test. So I'll go to test. And then from here, I'm going to click on load test, and I'll be able to see all the load tests that I'm running, including the load tests that come from the Azure portal. If we remember the name of that particular test, which I believe is this one here, we can now see the same results that we saw inside of the Azure portal directly from inside of Visual Studio Team Services. If I were to open this up, you'll get very similar charts that let me know again the average response time, the user load, how long the test ran, and if there were any errors or not. It also shows me my slowest request. Of course, we only made one, so that will be the slowest request. Now, you can also create that exact same test from here, but you'll have more control if you do it from inside of Visual Studio Team Services. For example, not only can I create the same type of user-based test with a URL, but I can also use a Visual Studio test, which we'll learn how to create here in just a moment. I can use an archive file from Fiddler if you've been using that to track your traffic, or I can even use Apache JMeter if you're using that instead. But let's duplicate the same test that we created just a moment ago and see that we actually have more power when we do it inside of Visual Studio Team Services. We're just going to go ahead and give this a temporary name. And I can add additional URLs, which I could not do before. It was only one URL, and I could only do a get. But here inside of Visual Studio Team Services, I can do a get, post, put, delete, all the different types of methods that I'd want to perform against my particular endpoint. If I were to choose post, for example, I can come down here and give it a content type and actually give in the information that I'd want. In addition to that, I can click on settings, which allows me to set the duration, also change the load pattern that I want to apply to my application. Do I want all 250 people to hit it all at once, or do I want to slowly build up to 250 as the application starts to become more popular? I'll do constant here for now. I can choose the number of people, the warm-up, and I can also control the browser mix, which I could not control from inside the Azure portal. Another thing that I can do is choose from a much larger list of regions. As you'll notice, this list is much larger than the list that we had inside of the Azure portal. If you've already taken the time to set up your own physical rig, you could actually use that rig here as well. But the advantages of using the cloud really make creating your own rig a thing that we don't do anymore. Now you get to use the power of the cloud to provision all the resources necessary to generate an enormous amount of load, and then when you're done, get rid of all those machines versus you having those physical machines yourself. Once you're done with that, you're going to have a test very similar to what we did before, and your results are going to look just like they did when they came from the Azure portal. Here I can open up one of my runs. Again, I can see my average response, the number of users I used, how long I ran it, and any errors that I actually had that fell to that particular test. Now, you may have noticed that as we move along, we're getting more and more control over the load test that we run. And there's one other way that you can actually create your load test. One of them is directly inside of Visual Studio itself. There is a solution type that you can create where you can actually author the test that you want to run. If I were to open up this web test, you can actually see the request that I made. And let me bring up the properties for you. And when you bring up the properties, you'll see that there's so much more control. Not only do I have the control over the method, but even the version of the transport protocol that I want to use, the URL that I want to actually hit, and I can even control the headers that get sent. If I want to enable gzip, for example, or if I want to make sure that it sends me back XML versus JSON, I get to control all of the headers, which are really, really important. Another thing that's really important is your ability to add validation to the request and the response. In the previous test, we were sending the request, and if we were getting a 200, we assumed that everything was good. But what if I got a 200, but the data inside of it was not the data that I was expecting? We were not able to test that with the other two methods. But here, I can actually add a validation rule. Because I know I'm going to be getting XML back, I can actually say, let's go and require that there be a first name tag. And in that first name, let's say, for example, Jessica is the value that I want inside of it. I can actually use these tags and these validation rules to be able to verify that I actually got the data that I wanted to. And if we run it at load, weird things don't start to happen. So again, we're starting to get more and more power and control over the load test that we're running as we get closer to Visual Studio. Once you have your test authored, you can actually go off and create a load test. A load test allows you to control what computers are used, what addresses are hit, what browser mix that you want, what network mix that you want as well. If you wanted to pretend that some people were coming from a phone using 3G or 4G versus coming from a landline, you can do that to make sure that the responses work the way that you want to. You also have the ability to set thresholds, which are really important. Response times are great, but what if I wanted to check other metrics on my application? Here under the load test settings, I'm able to drill into any item that I want to and actually set a threshold. A threshold is a value that I want to be watched during the execution of my test. And if those values are ever eclipsed, I'm able to then be notified that at this point in your test, we had a threshold violation. You weren't able to sustain as many simultaneous users. Maybe your response time went up, your error counts went up, but you are now in complete control of what's important to you and what needs to be monitored during your test. Once this is done, you then execute the test like we did before, and we're going to be utilizing the resources that are in Azure to generate the load for you. If you want, again, you can actually use your own laptop for a small load or stand up your own rig, but I would encourage you to make sure you really don't want to use the stuff that's in the cloud because it's really, really nice, and it makes life so much easier than having to provision a rig yourself. Once the test is done, you'll be able to see all of the results like we did before, but we get much more detailed results when we actually run them inside of Visual Studio. Using this full testing, I can see the thresholds that were violated. And as you can see, I set a threshold to see what my requests per second were going to be. And if they ever dropped below 100, I wanted to be alerted. And at one point during my test, they dropped to 83.26, which let me know that at some point, my infrastructure was not able to sustain the same number of users that I wanted to. And I might want to go and investigate this and figure out what's going on. Any threshold violations that might have happened would have been shown for me here automatically. I can also go back in and look at the performance results, download the details, and see all of the information that was happening during the execution of my test. Now, load test is great as a one-off that you might want to go off and run. But being a DevOps guy, I want to figure out how I can do this all the time throughout my entire pipeline. And what's really nice is using Visual Studio Team Services, you can take the information that I just showed you and incorporate it into your build and your release pipeline. I'm going to take you to an existing release pipeline, and I'm going to show you the tasks that you can use to run these tests during your actual release. In doing so, you no longer have to stop what you're doing and manually run them. Your release is going to tell you if you've made any detrimental changes to the performance of your application while you're deploying your code through your pipeline. A lot of people do this during their QA or their staging environments, which should look very, very similar to their production environment. And in doing so, they're able to determine if the changes that they've made have had a detrimental effect on their actual performance. And as you can see here on my release pipeline, if I go to the QA environment and look at the task here, I actually happen to be running a performance test as part of my release. There's other tasks that I can use as well. So if I come here and I simply search for load test, you will see that there's several test tasks that I can use to run load test as part of my release pipeline, allowing me to make sure that none of my code has actually had a detrimental impact on my performance. Before I go, I want to encourage you to visit docs.microsoft.com to learn more about load testing.